Assalamu alaikum students, welcome back to another video. Today we will be solving Cambridge IGCSE Physics Paper 4 Variant 42 of February-March 2022. Also a quick reminder that all of the revenue generated from these videos will be sent to the aid of our Palestinian brothers and sisters. So please support us. Question 1. A ball rolls down a ramp and onto a horizontal surface. The first section of the horizontal surface is smooth. The second section of the horizontal surface is rough. Figure 1.1 shows a speed time graph for the ball. State the time when the ball reaches the start of the rough section of the horizontal surface. So we know that it reaches the horizontal surface at this point. When the speed starts to change. So when you zoom in, you can see that this is 2.2. So 2.2 seconds. At 2.2 seconds, it reaches the start of the rough section. Explain how figure 1.1 shows that there is no resultant force on the ball when it rolls along the smooth section of the horizontal surface. So during this section, we know that there is no resultant force because the speed is constant. So you can write constant speed. Constant speed tells us that there is no resultant force. Using figure 1.1, determine the acceleration of the ball as it rolls down the ramp. So it rolls down the ramp at this point. So this is when it is rolling down the ramp. So acceleration we know is given by final speed minus initial speed over the time taken. So the final speed is at this point, which we can see is 12.8, and initial speed we know is 0, time taken is 1.5 seconds. So acceleration is 12.5 minus 0 over 1.5. So this will give us 8.5 meters per second squared. The ball starts from rest at the top of the ramp. Show that the length of the ramp is 9.6 meters. So how can we calculate the length of the ramp? The length of the ramp is basically the distance the ball travels on the ramp. So it is once again this distance. We can calculate it using area under the graph. We can form a triangle. So we know the base is 1.5 and height is 12.8. So half base into height, 1.5 times 12.8. Put this in the calculator and your answer will come out to be 9.6 meters. Question 2. Figure 2.1 shows a spring balance used to measure the weight of a baby. The spring inside the balance extends when a mass is suspended from it. The dial shows the extension of spring as a value of mass in kilograms. State Hooke's law. So what does Hooke's law say? It says that the extension of the spring is directly proportional to the force or the load applied. So extension of spring directly proportional to force applied, and this is for before it reaches or before it exceeds the limit of proportionality. So Hooke's law is only applicable before the limit of proportionality. State the relationship between the mass of the baby and the force exerted on the spring due to the baby. So we know that the force is basically the weight, and force is directly proportional to the mass. So we have the formula W is equal to mg. In this case, W is our force, and we can see that it is directly proportional to the mass. So force directly proportional to mass. The reading on the spring balance is 8 kilograms. Determine the force exerted on the spring due to the baby. So we know the force is the weight, so we are given weight by mg, mass is 8, gravitational field strength we can write as 10, so 80 newtons. The limit of proportionality for the spring is at a force of 175 newtons. Sketch the extension load graph for the spring. The sketch must continue beyond a force of 175 newtons. So before the limit of proportionality, which is at 175 newtons, it will obey Hooke's law and hence it will be a straight line with constant gradient. But when it reaches the limit of proportionality, it will stop obeying Hooke's law and it will become something like this. I'll make it slightly better. So basically this shows that the extension and load are not proportional anymore when it reaches the limit of proportionality. The baby is carried from the ground floor to the bedroom. The vertical height of the bedroom above the ground is 3.5 meters. Calculate the change in gravitational potential energy of the baby when it is carried from the ground floor to the bedroom. So we know gravitational potential energy is given by mgh. Mg is basically W, and we know that is 80 newtons, and the change in height is 3.5. So 80 times 3.5 gives us 280 joules. Question 3, figure 3.1 and figure 3.2 show how a puddle of water changes on a warm windy day. Describe the process by which the volume of water in the puddle decreases. So we know that the puddle decreases due to evaporation, and evaporation happens when the more energetic molecules or the molecules with the higher energy, they escape from the top of the liquid or from the surface. So evaporation is the process. And how does it occur? When energetic molecules escape from the surface. State and explain one change in the weather that would cause the volume of water in the puddle to decrease more slowly. So if there is lower temperature, it will decrease the rate of evaporation. Explain in terms of molecules how sweating helps to cool your body on a hot day. So thermal energy in our skin, that is transferred to the molecules of the sweat, and these molecules, since they have high energy, they escape from the skin. It is very similar to evaporation, and when the higher energy particles, they leave the body, so they leave behind the molecules with lower energy, and that those molecules obviously have lower temperatures as well, so it allows your body to cool down. So you can write this in points. Thermal energy is transferred to sweat particles or molecules. हायर एनर्जी पार्टिकल स्केप बॉडी। Leaving behind the lower energy particles. Question 4. A sample of sand has a volume of 0.05 meter cube. The density of the sand is 1900 kilograms per meter cube. The specific heat capacity of sand is 1500 joules per kilogram Celsius. Calculate the mass of the sample of sand. So we know the formula. Density is equals to mass over volume. Density we know is 1900. Mass we have to find out. Volume we are given 0.05. So just plug this in the calculator and your mass will come out to be 95 kilograms. Calculate the thermal capacity of the sample of sand. So thermal capacity, call it capital C, will be given by mass into the specific heat capacity, which is 1500. So mass we just calculated as 95, specific heat capacity is 1500. So the answer you will get is 140,000 joules per Celsius. The initial temperature of the sample of sand is 7 Celsius. The sample of sand is heated using an electric heater. The power of the heating element is 50 watts. Calculate the time taken to increase the temperature of the sand to 19 Celsius. So we know the formula for specific heat capacity, and the energy required is MC delta T. We have to calculate the time taken, and we are given the power. So we know the formula, energy is equal to power into time. So replace energy by power into time. Mass we have 95, specific heat capacity we know is 1500, change in temperature is from 7 to 19, which is 12. So we'll bring power here, which is 50. You have to calculate the time. So when you plug this in the calculator, you will get your answer as 34,000 seconds. This is a rounded off value, 34,000 seconds. In some countries, the soil is too cold for plants to grow well. In these countries, plants are grown in plastic rods and kept inside. The pots containing soil are placed on sand. The sand is heated using an electric heater as shown. Describe in terms of molecules how thermal energy is transferred from the heated sand through the base of the plastic pot. So when the sand particles, when they are heated, they gain kinetic energy, and obviously they then vibrate, and then due to the vibration the thermal energy is transferred to the plastic pot. You can write it as sand molecules gain KE due to which they vibrate with greater energy. And then they transfer the energy through conduction. To conduction and to the collision of particles. The heating element in figure 4.1 remains switched on. The temperature of the sand remains constant at a value above room temperature. Explain why the temperature of the sand remains constant. So despite the heating element being switched on, the sand temperature remains constant. So why is that? This is because the rate of thermal energy supplied to the sand is equal to the rate of thermal energy being lost from the sand. So that is why the temperature remains constant. So rate of energy supplied is equal to rate of energy lost. Question 5. A boy looks at the image of a clock in a plane mirror. Figure 5.1 shows the mirror, the clock and the position of one of the boy's eyes. On figure 5.1, draw a ray of light from the clock reflected to the boy's eye. So we will take a ray of light that starts from the clock and then it is reflected to the boy's eye. Here we have to make sure that the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. So this angle must be equal to this. These must be the same because this is the principle of reflection. Figure 5.1, mark with an X the position of the image of the clock. So we know that it will be formed somewhere over here on behind the mirror, or you can call it on the mirror as well. So somewhere over here should be vertical, so at this point. State whether the image formed by the mirror is virtual or real. Explain your answer. So we know that images formed on a mirror are always virtual, and this is because light does not or cannot pass through the image. So those images through which light cannot pass, those are virtual. Virtual, and obviously the image is being formed on a mirror, right? So light cannot pass through it. Figure 5.2 shows the image of the clock seen by the boy. The boy now looks directly at the clock. On figure 5.3, draw what the boy sees. So this is the image that the boy sees on the clock, on the mirror of the clock. So when the boy looks directly on the clock, what image will we see? So this is a reflected image, so the real image would have been this. The clock is illuminated by a source of monochromatic green light. State the meaning of monochromatic. So monochromatic is light of a single frequency. This is the definition. The green light has a wavelength of 5.6 into 10 to the power minus 7 meters. Calculate the frequency of this green light. So we know the formula, V is equal to F lambda. V, the speed of light, which is 3 into 10 to the power 8. Frequency we have to calculate. Lambda we are given. 5.6 into 10 to the power minus 7. So just put this in a calculator and your frequency will come out to be 5.4 into 10 to the power 14 hertz. Do not forget to write the unit or else you will lose a mark. Question 6. Figure 6.1 shows two bar magnets. Sketch the pattern and the direction of the magnetic fields, field lines between the bar magnets. So we know the magnetic field lines travel from north to south. So like this. This would be the direction. Figure 6.2 shows the same bar magnets with a coil of wire between them. Name the parts labeled A in figure 6.2. So these parts, what are they called? They are slip rings. The coil of wire is rotated in the direction shown in figure 6.2. On figure 6.2, draw an arrow to show the direction of the current in the coil. Explain your answer. So we know that the current, the magnetic field and the direction of the force, they are all perpendicular to each other. So using the left hand rule, Fleming's left hand rule, you can see that the current will be in an anti-clockwise direction this way. So this will be the direction of the current. And why is that? Because they all are perpendicular to each other. So we can write mutually perpendicular. Mutually perpendicular means that they are all perpendicular to each other, all three of them. Explain how rotating the coil in figure 6.2 continuously causes the galvanometer needle to show an alternating current. So when you rotate the coil, the coil cuts the magnetic field lines. So they are magnetic field lines like this, and when the coil rotates, it cuts the magnetic field lines, which causes an induced EMF in the coil, and that induced EMF produces the current in the coil, which is then transferred to the galvanometer. So rotation, no, you can write coil cuts across field lines. This induces an EMF in the coil. This EMF causes a current. EMF gives rise to current, which is then transferred to the galvanometer. And why is the current an alternating current? Because the direction of current flow changes with each 180 degrees rotation of the coil. So when the coil reaches the vertical position, there is a change in the current because of the degree of rotation of the coil. So at each vertical position, the flow of the current changes. So direction of current changes with 180 degree rotation. Question 7. Figure 7.1 shows a circuit including a 12 volt battery and two identical lamps. The 12 volt battery consists of cells connected in series. Each cell in the battery has an electromotive force of 1.5 volts. determine how many cells are in the battery. So if the battery is of 12 volts and each cell has 1.5, so 12 divided by 1.5, it gives us 8. So there are 8 cells. When the switch is closed, the ammeter reading is 2.4 amperes. Calculate the total resistance of the circuit. Total resistance. So resistance formula we have R is equal to V upon I. We know the battery is of 12 volts, current is 2.4, total resistance we get as 5 ohms. Each lamp has a resistance of 3 ohms. Calculate the resistance of Q. So each of these lamps have 3 ohms. And you have to calculate the resistance of Q. And we know the total resistance is 5 ohms. So we can calculate the total resistance of these two lamps since they are connected in parallel. We can use this formula. 1 over RT is equal to 1 over 3 plus 1 over 3. So this will give us RT as 1.5. So these two lamps have a collective resistance of 1.5 and the total is 5. So how much would be off for Q? So Q you would get as 5 minus 1.5, which would give you 3.5 ohms. On figure 7.1, draw a symbol for a voltmeter that measures the potential difference across the two lamps. So we know that in order to calculate the potential difference using a voltmeter, we have to connect it in parallel with the two lamps. So like this. Calculate the power supplied to one lamp. So the power, we know the formula for power is P is equal to VI. You can also use this alternate formula I square R. It is basically the same formula, just written in a different manner. So the power supplied to one lamp, current we know is how much they have given us is 2.4. But here you need to be careful that you need to calculate the power of just one lamp. So if the current is 2.4 amperes, how much current would one lamp get? We know that in parallel the current gets divided equally. So the current will get divided into 2. So this would get 1.2 and this would also get 1.2 because total current we have is 2.4 amperes. So I square R would give us 1.2 square times the resistance. Resistance of the lamp we know is 3. So when you solve this, you will get 4.3 watts. Question 8. A radio is connected to the mains supply using a step-down transformer. Draw a label diagram of the structure of a basic step-down transformer. So they've told us that it is a step-down transformer, which means that the primary coil will have a greater amount of turns as compared to the secondary coil, because it is a step down, which means voltage is decreasing. So we'll just make a basic structure of a transformer with the primary coil having a greater amount of turns. So this is the primary coil, we'll call it PC, and the secondary coil we call it SC. So you can see that the primary coil has a greater amount of turn as compared to the secondary coil. Explain the operation of a basic transformer. So we know that the primary voltage in the primary coil causes an alternating current. So primary voltage, I'll call that PV, causes alternating current AC in primary coil, I'll call it PC. This produces a magnetic field, call it mag field, which induces an EMF across the secondary coil. part C. The voltage of the main supply is 230 volts. The output voltage of the transformer is 6 volts. Calculate the value of the turns ratio. Give your answer to two significant figures. So we know that this is the ratio. This ratio is equals to the ratio of the voltage as well. So if we can calculate the ratio of this, we'll have the answer would be the same for the turns ratio. So secondary voltage we know is 230. Sorry, secondary voltage is 6 volts. Primary voltage is 230. So this ratio comes out to be 0.026. Question 9. Figure 9.1 shows a digital circuit. Explain what is meant by digital. So digital means a signal that has one of two possible states. Table 9.1 is a truth table for the digital circuit shown. Calculate the column C and D. So first you have to identify which logic gate is shown here. So this is an AND gate. You must be able to identify, and this is a NOT gate. So we know that an AND gate only has an output of 1 when both the inputs are 1, and the rest it will be 0. So 0 will give you 0, 0 1 will give you 0, 1 0 will also give you 0, and 1 1 will give you 1. And then when this goes through a NOT gate, all the outputs will get reversed. So 0 becomes 1 and 1 becomes 0. Take the single logic gate that would produce the same output D from the inputs A and B. So that would be for a NAND gate, because a NAND gate is a combination of an AND gate and a NOT gate. The isotope americium 241 is represented by this. This isotope decays by an alpha emission to an isotope of neptunium. Complete the nuclide equation for this decay. So we know that alpha emission is of this nature. So just balance the equation on both sides. And 93. Figure 10.1 shows a simple diagram of a smoke detector. The smoke detector contains a small sample of americium 241. This isotope ionizes the air between the metal plates in the detector. Describe how the americium 241 ionizes air. So it emits alpha particles which hit the molecules in the air between the metal plates, and due to this collision the electrons are removed. So alpha particles emitted. Which hit or collide or strike, whichever word you use, with air particles which removes electron. And this removal of electron is basically ionization. Suggest and explain two reasons why smoke detectors use an isotope that emits alpha particles rather than an isotope that emits gamma radiation. So this is because alpha particles are more highly ionizing than gamma rays, and they ionize air easily. So alpha particles are more ionizing. And the other reason can be that alpha particles are not as penetrating as gamma radiation, and hence they are stopped by the smoke particles and they are easier to detect. So less penetrating. due to which they are easily detected by the smoke detectors. Okay, so that brings us to the end of our paper. I hope you liked this video, and if you did, please leave a like and subscribe to our channel, and I'll see you later.